need thee every hour, most gracious Lord. No tender voice like thine can peace afford. I need thee every hour, stay thou nearby. Temptations lose their power when thou art nigh. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. I need thee, I need thee. I need thee every hour. I need thee, I need thee. I need thee every hour. I need thee every hour, in joy or pain. Come quickly and abide, for life is in vain. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. I need thee, I need thee. I need thee every hour. Bless me now, my Savior, I come to thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior, I come to thee. I need thee every hour, teach me thy will. And now its promises, in me fulfilled. I need thee, oh, I need thee, oh, I need thee every hour. I need thee, I need thee, I need thee every hour. I need thee, I need thee, I need thee every hour.
Good morning. Welcome to the Heartland United Methodist Church. My name is Paul Gruenberg. I'm the pastor here, and I want to welcome you as we gather together online, virtually, but still gather together in our hearts to worship God together. Amen? Give me a thumbs up. Amen. Hey, make sure you have grabbed that beverage that you like to drink in the morning, whether it's warm or hot. I hope you have your Bible. You can turn your Bible to Luke chapter 21. That's Luke chapter 21. He's found in the New Testament. And then also, as we go along, if God is speaking to you, use those emojis, the heart-shaped one or the thumbs up or another emoji that you might find as you're Facebooking live. Use those. And then also, later on in our service, there will be an opportunity for us to pray together. And I encourage you to add the name, just the first name, of a person that you want us to pray for. We'll make sure those names get placed on our prayer list and that people are praying for the particular request. As we begin our service, I want us to begin with a word of prayer. Just bow your head, close your eyes. Lord, we're grateful for this opportunity to love on you. And Lord, to set aside this time for you. We ask in Jesus' name that you would just enjoy us as we worship you, Lord, that you would be glorified in our hearts and minds. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, say it with me. Amen. Amen. As always, I've got a question for you, and my question is this. What is the perfect ending to a movie? What is a perfect ending for you to a movie? It could be that all the loose ends are tied up and in a nice little bow. It could be that some of the other storylines are not quite as tied up as the main storyline. And then there are those movies or stories that leave you hanging. What is the kind of completion? What is the perfect ending of a movie for you? Think about that. Write it down on your sheet of paper and give it some deep thought. Now, as you continue to do that, I'm going to slide over here and we're going to join in our call to worship this morning. Let's join together. Hey, when we join together, say it out loud, would you? Let's join together in our call to worship. In you, Lord, I take my refuge as we face this season of life together. As I worship you, help me to always turn to you and worship you with all of my being. May you be glorified, my rock and my fortress. Amen and amen. So let's join together in our first song this morning. It's a wonderful song. It's an old song, but it's a powerful song. Join with me as we sing, "And Can It Be?" Singing out loud, God's listening.
He left his father's throne above, to be so infinite his grace. He himself all but love. His mercy all immense and free. God, it reaches me. Amazing love, how can it be that thou, my God, should die for me? No condemnation now I dread. Jesus and all in him is
is mine. Alive in Him, my living head, and clothed in righteousness divine. Bold I approach the eternal throne, and in the crown to Christ my own.
Sing it out.
Amazing love, how can it be that Thou, my God, should die for me?
One more time.
Amazing love, how can it be that Thou, my God, should die for me?
Amen. Amen. Let's join together now in a statement of faith. Again, I encourage you to speak these words out loud and speak them from your heart to God. We believe in the one God, creator and sustainer of all things, father of all nations, the source of all goodness and beauty, all truth and love. We believe in Jesus Christ, God manifest in the flesh, our teacher, example, and redeemer, the Savior of the world. We believe in the Holy Spirit, God present with us for guidance, for comfort, and for strength. We believe in the forgiveness of sins, in the life of love and prayer, and in grace equal to every need. We believe in the Word of God, contained in the Old and New Testaments, as the sufficient rule both of faith and of practice. We believe in the church, those who are united in the living Lord, for the purpose of worship and service. We believe in the reign of God, as the divine will realized in human society, and in the family of God, where we are all brothers and sisters. We believe in the final triumph of righteousness and in the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you for joining me in that affirmation of faith. It's so important that we find ways to affirm our faith, even when we're using creeds, something that was written thousands of years ago or hundreds of years ago. It's important to affirm our faith. Now let us sing a song written by the Gaithers, I believe, Something Beautiful, Something Good.
Something beautiful, something good. All my confusions He understood. All I had to offer Him was brokenness and strife, but He made something beautiful my life.
Let's sing it again.
Something beautiful, something good. All my confusion He understood. All I had to offer Him was brokenness and strife, but He made something beautiful of my life.
God is always in the business of making something beautiful of our lives. Even when you can't see it, God's at work, helping you to live into goodness, into righteousness, into love. So as we continue along in our service, we want to begin to look at today's scripture. And today's scripture is from the book of Luke, the Gospel of Luke, and that's in chapter 21 of Luke. Now, the biographies of Jesus, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, were all written together to help us know and understand who Jesus was, how he lived, the things that he taught, and as an example for us, Jesus gave us so that we could live a life that is pleasing to God. Of the four Gospels, three of them are called synoptics. That's Matthew, Mark, and Luke, because they all write about, they all write in the same way about the life of Jesus. John takes a different viewpoint of Jesus. And so the Matthew, Mark, and Luke are called the synoptic Gospels. And in the Gospels, all four of them, there are 46 parables that are recorded of Jesus. 45 of those parables are written in the Synoptic Gospels. And of the 45 that are written in the Synoptic Gospels, only six, well, I've been saying six, but there are seven. We did two and one on the first week, but there are seven parables that are written in all three of the Synoptic Gospels. And today we're going to look at our final parable that are written in all three Synoptic Gospels. Let us pray. Almighty God, we are grateful for your love and grace which leads us through our years and ask in Jesus' name that as we take time now with you to hear your word, Lord, that you would cause us to hear your still small voice. And Lord, that your word would penetrate us and that your Holy Spirit would speak to us in that still small voice. Lord, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart would be pleasing to you, my rock and my Savior. Amen. You know, this is one of those scriptures that I really had to wrestle with, and like a really good movie, you think you're going right in one direction with Christ, and then he does a twist. I mean, a whole new thing. And I wrestled with that this week, and I want to share it with you. Now, as we asked the question early on, what's the way you like a movie to end? And as a family, we watched Cinderella the other day. Not Cinderella, I'm sorry. We watched Sleeping Beauty the other day. It was a movie created by Disney about 32 years after he began making full-length animated pictures. And in that animated film, there are a number of characters. There's the king and the queen, and then there's their child, Princess Aurora. And then there's Maleficent and the other three good fairies. Maleficent, in an act of meanness, condemns Sleeping Beauty to death by pricking her finger on the spindle of a spinning wheel. But then the last fairy says, no, she won't die, but she will sleep until true love's kiss. Isn't that a great story, until true love's kiss? Of course, if you haven't seen the movie in a while, Maleficent seems like she's a pretty strong character toward the end, and all of a sudden Prince Philip comes and vanquishes Maleficent, and true love's kiss wakes Sleeping Beauty. Oh, I'm sorry. Did I just give the end away? Oh, I am so sorry. That was quite a twist in there. You thought Maleficent was going to win the day, but then all the bows are tied up nicely. She is no longer, or as I said, Philip vanquishes her. True love's kiss wins the day, and the story ends happily ever after. I love a story that ends happily ever after. But in the story of Sleeping Beauty, that's the final word. That's how it ends. You can't change it. That's interesting, because as we come to our last parable that Jesus tells, he does a couple of interesting things. The parable is told just like the last parable in Jesus' last week. He's at the temple courts. The disciples and all the people are gathered around him learning from Jesus. And then as they walk away, the disciples notice something. And what they notice, As they walk along, they see the wonderful structures, the magnificent temple and its building, the blocks of stone that may be 1 or 2 tons. And they say to Jesus how the temple was adorned with these beautiful stones and with gifts dedicated to God. But Jesus says in verse 6, read it with me, "As for what you see here, the time will come when not one stone will be left on another. Every one of them will be thrown down." Now, it would be strange if you were walking along this great building, or if you were walking in our church, to think that one day that this structure will be just a pile of rubble. It would be strange to think of that. And I'm sure for the disciples, it was an odd thought to think that these huge, massive stones would be thrown down and not one on top of another again. And moving on, they said this to Jesus. Read it with me. "Teacher," they ask, "when will these things happen? And what will be the sign that they are about to take place?" Now, there's really two questions here, and they're asking, when will these things happen? Matthew takes a different viewpoint, and he says, "What will be the sign of your coming?" They ask about the stones, and then they ask, "What will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age?" So there's really two questions, and Luke doesn't really make that differentiation clear as Matthew does. So the answer Jesus gives is, he says, "Watch out that you are not deceived, for many will come in my name claiming I am he, and the time is near. Do not follow them. When you hear of wars and uprisings, do not be frightened. These things must happen first, but the end will not come right away." And historically, we know that the temple, those massive boulders, were indeed thrown down, and one was not on top of another in about 70 AD, when Nero had Jerusalem completely demolished, blaming the Christians for setting fire to Rome. So in the first part, all of those stones, indeed, as the disciples were asking, when will this happen? Now, after Jesus shares these words about the time not being near, or people coming and claiming that they are his or they are him, he goes on to say some pretty, pretty scary words. Words like, "Watch out that you are not deceived. Nation will rise against nation. There will be great earthquakes, famines, and pestilences in various places. But before all this, they will seize you and persecute you. There will be those who will persecute you. They will hand you over to synagogues and put you in prison, and there you will be brought before kings and governors, and all on account of my name." So for those who believe in Jesus with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength, you'll be brought before kings and governors, and so you will bear testimony to me, Jesus says. Now this is one of those cool twists. "But make up your mind not to worry beforehand how you will defend yourselves, for I will give you words and wisdom that none of your adversaries will be able to resist or contradict." Isn't that cool? That the Holy Spirit within us is going to give us the words that we need. Now, the problem here is that too many Christians who are not in the Word of God, who have not really spent time with Christ, I think even though the Holy Spirit will help them, it will not be as powerful as those who have spent time with Jesus in his word, as those who have allowed God's word to form them, to inform them, to transform them into being more like Christ. And then Jesus goes on, "You will be betrayed even by parents, brothers, sisters, relatives, and friends, and they will put some of you to death." Some will die for the name of Christ. We see that in third world countries. We see that in places where the church is underground, that people are being put to death. for the name of Christ. I wonder sometimes if I would be strong enough if I lived over in that country to proclaim the name even if it meant my life. How about you? Do you think you could stand for the word of Christ regardless of what's happening around you? I hope so. It says, everyone will hate you because of me, but not a hair of your head will perish. Stand firm and you will win life. Not a hair of your head will perish. That's interesting. After he said, some of you will die. Then we see these words. When you see Jerusalem being surrounded by armies, you will know that its desolation is near. How dreadful those days will be for all who live. And then these words in verse 25. There will be signs in the sun, moon, and stars. On the earth, nations will be in anguish and perplexity at the roaring and tossing of the sea. People will faint from terror, apprehensive of what is coming on the world, for the heavenly bodies will be shaken. And if you go back to Matthew, whose version has a little bit of twist, we'll say that the sun, the moon, and the stars, that things are going to be happening. And he references Joel to where he talks about them falling from the sky. It will be a dreadful day. And so he goes on to say, at that time, they will see the Son of Man coming in the cloud with power and great glory. Amen? Amen. Christ is coming back. When these things begin to take place, stand up and lift up your heads because your redemption is drawing near. Redemption, Matthew uses the word for your salvation, is drawing near. It keeps getting worse and worse and worse, but it's not the end. There is a new beginning about to happen. You know, for some of you, when you graduated from middle school, that was an ending, but there was a new beginning, and that was high school. When you graduated from high school, there was either work or college. When you graduated from college, there was work, maybe marriage, love, maybe babies. 30 years, 35, 40 years later, you're looking at another ending, but it truly is retirement. It truly leads to a new beginning. And even though Jesus is talking about this ending here, this world ending, he's saying that I'm coming to get you back. There's going to be a new beginning. Isn't that great news? Say amen. And then he tells the parable that we've come to listen to today. He says, look at the fig tree and all the trees. Let's see if I've got that on here for you. Read it with me. Look at the fig tree and all the trees. When they sprout leaves, you can see for yourselves and know that summer is near. Even so, when you see these things happening, you know that the kingdom of God is near. This is great news to live your life on. Now, for those of us who believe, it's easy to just live our lives on that. And yet, for those who are struggling with identifying Jesus as the Savior of the world or identifying Jesus as God, I want to remind you that Jesus, who said these words, who warned us about the times that will come, is the same Jesus that raised a guy who was dead for 4 days from the dead, Lazarus. He was dead for 4 days and he spoke and said, come out, and Lazarus came out. I know nobody else who has done that in this world. Jesus also, if you remember, healed many people. Jesus spoke powerful words to the people of his day. He told stories that people could understand. And ultimately, he reminded people that even though you tear this temple down himself, it will be raised again in 3 days. And on the third day, he did rise again from the grave. 500 or more people at one time saw him alive. It's that same Jesus who tells us that even when these bad things seem that the earth is coming to an end, even so, when you see these things happening, you know that the kingdom of God is near. Isn't that wonderful good news? And then, And then Jesus adds these words that I really had to wrestle with. Read them with me. Truly, I tell you, this generation will certainly not pass away until all these things have happened. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. Truly, I tell you, this generation will certainly not pass away until all these things have happened. And remember, there are two questions. When are the stones coming down? And when will the sign of the end come? And so there are two questions. They don't have to happen one right after the other. There can be years and years separating the two events. But when the end times come, that generation will certainly not pass away until the end. And then Jesus says these words, my words will never pass away. Again, here we have the Savior of the world, the one who brings life with his spoken word, the one who raises people from the dead, and he himself was risen from the grave. And he says, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. We see the story, the context of this parable, talking about the end times. And yet what the parable is reminding us is that it's not just about the end times, but that it's about Jesus saying, my words will never, never pass away. You and I need to stand on that word. That word that says that salvation is near when Christ comes back, that heaven is real, and that one day those who believe in Jesus as Savior of the world will one day be in heaven with Jesus, with God the Father and the Holy Spirit, and with all who have believed. If there isn't good news today, that is the greatest news. It is the twist in our story today, that Jesus isn't just talking about the end, but he's talking about the truth, that his words will remain forever. They will never pass away. So when you get your Bible and you're reading it and you're asking God for a word and God gives you a word from his Bible, you can stand on that truth. It will never pass away. Amen? Amen. Sometimes we need to be reminded that, and today is that reminder. So let us pray. Almighty God, we're grateful for Jesus's reminder that things, even though there's a beginning, there will be an end to this life, and yet it will be a beginning to the next. And we ask in Jesus' name, Lord, that you would help us to just trust you, to just rely on your word, which is a firm and solid foundation. And Lord, that one day we all will join you in the heavens. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Say amen out loud. Amen. Let's sing a song that reminds us that there is a heaven, that we will one day be there. And I'm not sure that you're going to, well, yes, you are. I need to stop my screen. There you go. We're going to sing When We All Get to Heaven. Hey, there's another voice you might be hearing. That's Charles. Charles is helping to get this off the ground, and I appreciate Charles's work, and you will appreciate it too. Hopefully you're appreciating it now, but you'll appreciate it too when we continue to move forward with this whole live streaming and broadcasting our services. Let's sing the song.
Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, What a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory. While we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sign. What a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one hymn of glimpsing glory will the toils of life repay. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Onward to the prize before us, soon his beauty will behold. Soon the pearly gates will open, we shall tread the streets of gold. Say amen. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory.
Amen. Amen. I can't wait for that day to come. But until it does come, remember to live for Christ, to glorify God in all that you say and all that you do. It's here now that we would, in our service, have an opportunity to give back to God a portion of what He has given to us. And so, in this moment, if you haven't had an opportunity to give, allow God to work in your life to not just give back offering, to not just give back money, but to give back more of you, your abilities, your talents, your time, to give that back to God. As always, there's an electronic option. If you prefer to send in through the U.S. mail, you may. And I want to thank you for those of you who have been actively participating in giving back to God. Again, not just monetarily, but also with your time and your talents. We give electronically, and so I just place this on the altar as a sign of all who are giving back to God. Let's just thank God for all that He's given to us by singing the doxology. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Amen. As we would normally, and we will now, let us join in a time of prayer. This is that opportunity again to put in the comments section below the Facebook screen names of people that you would like lifted up. You can give a name and maybe just a brief word or two of how we need to pray for them. You may also just thank God. Put a prayer of thanks on there. Thank God for His Word. Thank God for Jesus. Thank God for the Holy Spirit who lives in us. And thank God for a future that will come one day. Let us join together. Let's join our hearts together in prayer. Almighty God, we are grateful for this day and ask in Jesus' name that You would draw us closer to Yourself, Lord, that You would just place in us a reminder that heaven is near to us. that as the spring comes, as the leaves bud, there will be a time when Jesus comes back to us, and there will be signs. Lord, we just thank you and praise you for those who are dear to us, for those whom we love. Lord, we're grateful for the lives that people have lived. Lord, we're thankful for the healing of the people who have been healed from COVID-19. We thank you for the Hansons who are whole and healthy again. And yet, Lord, there are many who have not weathered the COVID-19. Lord, we have an Uncle Fred in our family who passed away this last week. And Lord, for all of those who mourn, we lift them up to you for the loss that they have suffered, for the inability to say goodbye. Lord, for the weight that we will have before we can celebrate their life as a family again. Lord, I just pray that you would see us through these days. Lord, for those who are mourning, for those who are weeping, Lord, remind them that there will be a time of rejoicing and dancing again, that COVID-19 will go away, that we will be able to gather together again, once again, to worship you in spirit and in truth. And Almighty God, we just thank you and praise you and just ask that you would hear our prayer. Take this moment, my friends, and lift up the name of those who are dear to you that need to be prayed for. Again, Almighty God, we thank you for sending your Son, Jesus, for giving us your Holy Spirit when we have believed on Jesus, that you may reside in us and lead us and guide us. We thank you for all that Jesus did, for all that he healed and we were able to see, for him rising from the dead, for the witnesses that bear that truth. And we thank you for the words that he taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever." Say it with me. Amen. Amen. Well, my friends, I pray that this has been a blessing to you and that God has been blessed by your worship of him during these few moments. And now I pray that the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus from now until we meet again. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Blessings, my friend, and until we meet again, amen.